far, we have seen a peaceful matinee at a fashionable theater. Stick 'em up! Holy bombshell! The crook caught by the Penguin! The loot restored, and a beautiful rich admirer found. Can it be that waddling master of foul play gone straight? Grill that crook. Make him admit he's a Penguin stooge. Useless. The bird won't sing. In the steam room of the Millionaires Club, an attempted kidnap. Again, foiled by the Penguin and his magic umbrella. The Penguin, set up in business, rival to the dynamic duo. Alfred the butler, an undercover agent, caught in the act. A desperate escape. The Penguin must be after those priceless jewels. Bait for a clever Penguin trap. But Penguin's too clever. Holy backfire, what a catastrophe! Snap goes the Penguin trap, cement-filled umbrellas, strung up behind the shooting gallery. Death at the unwitting hands of the police. Wait, the wildest is yet to come.
Welcome back, citizens, to an all-new episode of the Batcave Podcast. It's your old bat chum, John S. Drew here, and we're taking a look this time around at a new Penguin episode. Well, it'll be new for the podcast, not so new in terms of when it aired. The Penguin Goes Straight, Not Yet, He Ain't, two-parter, and these episodes aired on March 23rd, March 24th, 1966. And it actually ties in very nicely with many of the tropes that we're used to, and as far as the animated series portrayed him, I'm not so much sure about the comic books, and maybe my guest host today can help me fill in those gaps there. And when I say the tropes, as in the Penguin wanting to belong to high society. But before we talk about that, let me introduce our guest here. He is one of the co-moderators of the DragonCon American Sci-Fi Classics track. He is also one of the hosts, or the host actually specifically, of the RevCast News podcast. His name is Mr. Gary Mitchell. Welcome to the podcast, Gary. What is it about the Penguin? Because the last time we did a Penguin episode, Paul K. Bissett did his Penguin laugh too. What is it about the Penguin that we can automatically, a lot more than say the Joker or the Riddler, get into a character like that?
Well, it's a pretty iconic sound. I mean, it's Burgess Meredith just made it pop. And, you know, like you said, the Joker, pretty much all these, you know, and not everybody can do Cesar Romero's laugh. Not everybody can do Frank Gorshman's manic bouncing around. But, you know, just about anybody can go, wah, wah. And it's fun. It's fun to do that.
It is. And you know, as we mentioned in the first episode, that whole thing just came about because he was coughing over the cigarettes he had to smoke. Because he wasn't a cigarette smoker.
No, but it became an iconic piece of that character. You know, it was another piece of his penguinness. You know,
right.
He had his little penguin, you know, wah, wah. He did. That was one of the things when I was watching the episode again to refresh for this, was, you know, he waddles the entire time. He's walking from point A to point B. He does not walk like a normal person. He does that little side to side waddle like a penguin. And like, it was like, he stays in that character. And I think that's the reason they kept bringing him back. Because correct me if I'm wrong,
that.
He does the most appearances as a villain on the show.
I'd have to double check that. I know that it's either between him or Joker, because, you know, Julie Newmar was out, you know, for Catwoman. And yeah, they brought in Eartha Kitt and all, but I don't think she made that many appearances during the third season. And of course, Frank Gorshin was out the entire second season. So Yeah, you know, you might be right. That's something I'll have to take a look at and do a quick count there and see as far as between the two of them, who's got the most episodes. But I would imagine Burgess Meredith had probably more now that I come to think of it. I mean, he led off the third season with the whole Batgirl introduction, too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And he always had a really conniving plot every time. You know, he was somebody who, I mean, even in this episode, he's like, he gets the good advice.
Yes, he does. And just to let people know, I mean, the episode itself, as I said, he's trying to get into high society. He starts up a protection agency. He's coming across as though he's going legit. Mm-hmm. And yet there is definitely, as we'll quickly learn, well, actually not quickly. That's the other thing, too. I mean, certainly he's scheming throughout the whole thing, but we don't know what the whole plot is until the end, which is always, I thought, when you have a better Batman episode, when you don't really figure it out until the very end. Whereas in later seasons, you know, we get the plot right away. It's just a matter of watching Batman catch up with the villain and stop them from their plot. These early episodes, one thing leads to another, and we don't get the final, what's the whole point of this until the very end.
Yeah. Well, the plotting was much stronger in the first two seasons.
Yeah, it definitely was. It definitely was. All right, well, let's talk about this episode. And the first thing I got to ask you, Gary, mm-hmm. we start in the opening teaser with the Penguin coming out of the theater. They've just seen this performance there, and he's commenting on the performance, and
so superior to the sort of thing one usually sees.
Oh, yes, infinitely. And a leading man, my dear Mrs. Van Climer. This tremendous power.
Absolutely inspired, my dear Penguin.
It's a penetrating documentary in our times. It's a mirror of our cliched minds, of our sadly weakened moral fiber.
To me, the review sounded like he could have actually been reviewing Batman.
Mm-hmm.
And because the show could be very meta at times. And I'm wondering, did you get that?
They kind of came across that way to me, too. Well, I mean, that's, I think, part of the charm of the series is that it would go meta, that it would, you know, play with itself. They knew what they were doing. You know, they knew that they had drifted into high camp, I mean, right from the beginning. And I think that's one of the charms of the show is that it didn't take itself too seriously. So I could definitely agree with that.
You know, we quickly see Penguin take out, you know, our bad guy there, and of course he's the hero, and the commissioner is shocked, and he calls in Batman. You know, Batman's shocked. Now, it's funny because even Batman is willing to think bad of Penguin. Like, whereas other times, Batman is more than willing to give a bad guy a break and say maybe he can be rehabilitated. Like, it never occurs to Batman for a moment there, maybe this is legit, maybe we should just leave him alone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
in this particular episode.
Yeah, this one point, I think it's in the second episode, but it's not till the second episode where Robin at one point finally says, you know, the worst thing of all that could happen would be that he actually has gone straight.
yeah, it's true, because it's like then suddenly it's, you know, he's not the opposition, he's the competition.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, it's because of the fact that, you know, every time he shows up, he's up to something. He's got, you know, of Batman's foes in this show, he's pretty much the most conniving of all of them. He's always got a double blind going on.
He's always the most conniving, and he's always the one willing to use deadly force first.
Mm-hmm.
He's got the bullets in the gun. Like, I don't know of many other villains in the series who actually use guns. The Joker never pulls a gun.
No.
The Riddler, the one gun he has is a cigarette lighter in the first episode.
Yeah, well, and I think Penguin gets away with it because, you know, he's got the umbrella and they got to put something in there to make it a mm-hmm. weapon. And the easiest thing to do is turn it into a rifle. You know, he also does the smoke gas with it as well. And yeah, that's the other thing I like about Penguin is he's got gadgets.
Yes, he does. Well, he has gadgets and so does the Joker, though, for that mm-hmm. matter. The Joker, you know, I mean, they even did a whole episode with the utility belt and all. But yeah, I mean, the Penguin has gadgets, and he's got consistent gadgets, which you would think over time, and we'll talk about this later on in the episode, Batman would learn from that and not make the same mistake twice. But he does in this mm-hmm. episode. I like the fact that, you know, we get that the Batmobile has new gadgets now, according to Robin. They can test it all out, including the bulletproof windows, which never really play into the episode.
No.
They point that out, and then they don't use it.
I get the feeling that it may have been something in the original script that they modified.
It could, because one of the things they're always pretty good at in these early episodes of the season is it's like Chekhov's gun. If we point it out, we're going to use it at some point. We were just talking about a few weeks back in the Joker episode, they mentioned the power, which is play a part later on in rescuing Batman and Robin from the death trap the Joker lays for them.
Right.
So, you know, things like that, you know, it's like you got to pay attention because there are little things that they throw in there. Then they mention something like this and you're like, oh boy, you know, bulletproof windows and Penguin uses bullets. This is going to be good. And it never follows through. But
yeah, that's one of the only ones that happens, at least in this episode.
In this episode, and it doesn't really happen in the first. It's later on. Later on, they'll do things like that. They'll throw in things for whatever reason. Maybe it was, like you said, it's just a matter of it was originally in the script and they cut it, and it's just bad editing or what the deal was. But here in the first season, no, that's one thing you can say. Everything has a reason for being there, for whether it's for the joke, for the plot, for the story, for the character building. It's all there, and it serves a purpose. We don't get a commissioner's office scene this time.
Not really. We get a few scenes in the office, but we don't get the we have to call Batman moment.
We don't get the we have to call Batman, but we also don't get the Batmobile doesn't like pull up to Police Commissioner Gordon's office. We don't get that little think tank session thing they do all the time where it's like right out of Moonlighting. It's Batman and Robin in the car with the green screen behind them, you know, of the city driving by as they do the think session.
Thanks, Commissioner. We've got the picture. I'll call you back if Batman has any ideas. What do you think, Batman? Has the Penguin really gone straight?
It's a tough one. When that bird turns snow white, it could be merely a tricky whitewash job.
Right. But still, we've got to think of his record since he last left prison.
Clean as a whistle, it seems. Accepted in the best circles.
Not even a ticket for jaywalking. Could it be that he is reformed?
Or only pretending to reform? Stalking his next victim under the false colors of a crime fighter.
How the heck do we find out?
I have an idea.
What, Batman?
Say that caper at the theater was a Penguin ploy. Then that crook he caught must have been an accomplice, right?
On the nose!
Call the commissioner. Have him give that crook a grilling. We'll be there in time for the kill.
All they can come up with is, well, he's up to something.
Exactly. See, that's why you need to have the commissioner there. He helps.
Yeah.
But we do eventually get to the headquarters, not to the office itself, because they've got the guy that the Penguin captured.
All right, I'll ask you one more time. How long have you known the Penguin?
Who?
Quit lying, you cheap hoodlum. He paid you to pull that job, didn't he?
Told you to keep your mouth shut. Promised to cut you in on the big job later.
You guys must read too many comic books or something.
Hold it, Chief O'Hara. No rough stuff. It's our duty to abide by the rules. Now, this lying is useless. Besides, we have evidence.
Evidence?
The bulletproof umbrella. Why would the Penguin have carried a bulletproof umbrella to a matinee unless he expected your machine gun attack?
Who knows? Ask him.
A hard-baked cookie, this one.
Covered with armor-plated icing.
Let's give him a turn, shall we?
Hey, what's the matter, Sonny? Scared of the dark?
Ah! Help! There's bats loose in here! Ah! Holy knockout drops!
The miserable weakling, faded, dead away.
Looks like you overdid it, Batman.
There's only one thing to do now.
Find Penguin himself. Put the blocks to him.
Under all the lights and the intimidation and all that, and Chief O'Hara even threatening to, you know, crack him one, which I thought was funny.
Yeah, it was very amusing watching the commissioner and Chief O'Hara trying to be, you know, tough guys.
Right.
It's like, really, guys? Really?
Of course, then Batman shows up and his intimidation technique goes too far.
Yeah. Which I love, which for me is one of those moments of, oh, he knocked himself out. Well, we better come up with something else. No, can't we wake him up?
Can't we wake him up? No, that's it.
Can we wait? You know? No, he's out. We have to try something else. But, okay.
And it's funny, too, because there's, like, so many things they could have done, and what do they decide to do? And this is where I say Batman hasn't learned his lesson. Let's send Alfred in.
Yes.
For more of Alan Napier. I loved him as Alfred. He is my Alfred. When you talk about who's your definitive Batman, who's your definitive Joe, he's my definitive Alfred. I loved his, portrayal. But you're sending him in to get the goods on Penguin by having him put a listening device in Sasha Starr's apartment.
He's supposed to take pictures of the jewelry so they can create the fake ones.
Right.
So when the Penguin steals them, they can track them.
Right.
And he's putting the radio transceiver in the Penguin's cigarette holder.
Yes. But after the first time around, when dealing with bugging devices around the Penguin, when Bruce Wayne tried to do it in the first Penguin episode, you would think he'd realize that the Penguin, is very suspicious of people listening in on him. And of course, sure enough, his umbrella detects the listening device.
So you switched cigarette holders, did you? Yeah.
Freud's of Dublin, huh? I think not. Out with it, you criminal! Who are you working for?
It can happen to the best of us, Mr. Penguin, sir. One moment everything's going smoothly, and the next, fate pulls the rug out from under us.
Ah!
Good day, miss.
Yeah.
But,
But which is a fun gag. And then the rug gets pulled out from under us.
And he didn't have to be bionic or anything to get it this time.
Well, Burgess Meredith is not a big guy. I think my favorite part of that, though, is the whole Alfred's finished, he's packed up, and then the narrator goes, "Oh, Alfred, did you forget something?" and Alfred's got the look of, "Oh, yeah, right."
Well, that's the thing with having William Dozier there from time to time doing these, momentary, because we don't know the whole plot. I don't remember if Bruce Wayne explained that, or Batman explained, this is what you're going to do. So you needed, if you had Alfred suddenly just go, and make a face, people would be like, what's his problem? So having the narrator there, a few weeks ago, it was the same thing. The Catwoman episode where Batman and Robin are separated. So Batman's left alone to fight this tiger. And normally Batman would say, Robin, quickly put these on. I'm going to turn up the decibel volume on my radio receiver so this way we split the tiger's skull. He'd say that to Robin in the course of it all. He didn't have Robin there. So now you got William Dozier going, using his vast knowledge of audio-video techniques, Batman does this. It served a purpose there when you can't have, a proper expository dialogue, you bring in your narrator.
Yeah, because the only part we heard of the plan was the whole, we'll make the fake diamonds with the radioactive tracer on it.
Right.
Yeah, and it was very interesting to see that not work.
What's that?
The Penguin's radio detection thing went off. It was very interesting to see that happen. It was like, somebody's getting the best of Batman. There we go.
Well, but see, that's what I'm saying. It's like he should real, and again, this is a ploy that many times they're going to go to the well for and use it again is, here's the bug, or we'll chase them back to their lair. I mean, I know they need the goods on Penguin. In this case, they got to catch him in the trap. So at least here it works. But then there's a lot of other times where, even in the last episode with Catwoman, they spray the cat with radioactive mist in order to, after she steals it, they can trace her back. Why not just catch her right there in the act and be done with it? Instead, there is, excuse the pun, cat and mouse games going on. Here, at least it works in the plot. We don't have the goods on Penguin yet. Just catching him stealing the thing may not be good enough, because he could always come up with some, ploy that it's like, I felt it was better to move it somewhere. You need to actually have him with the goods in his lair with his other bad guys and round it all up. So I get it here. Mm-hmm. But again, the whole, listening device, tracking device, he should know better by now. That's not a gimmick that you can use, but he'll go back to that well again many, many times.
Yeah, well, Batman's a big surveillance guy. He likes his surveillance, I've noticed. Later in the second episode, they got the bugs in the Batmobile.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah. I guess it just has to do with the fact that, this is how he gathers his evidence, is through surveillance. I did like the fact, though, that once, you know, okay, Alfred gets away, at least he's got the pictures, so yes. They can duplicate the jewelry. And what I like is the fact that, you know, so they realize they still got to make the switch. So they go to Sophia Starr's hotel. And again, this is another staple of the first season. We don't get it as much in the second or third, or it's not as often. I like exterior shots. I like, you know, the nighttime and the Batmobile pulling up to the back of the hotel and all that. It had a nice atmosphere to the whole thing. And then, of course, you cut to, you know, the two of them climbing up the wall on stage. But, yeah. Oh, well, you can't have everything.
Mm-hmm. Which I was surprised that we didn't get the window gag here.
No, the window gags haven't started yet.
Yeah.
They haven't started yet. We're already, what, 10, 12 episodes into the series, and we haven't gotten the window gags yet.
Yeah.
You know, it's just instead of civics lessons.
The thing is, it became such an iconic part of the show that every time it doesn't happen, it's like, wait, where's the window gag?
Well, you know, you say that, but here's the thing. There were 120 episodes produced. There were only 12 window scenes in the entire series.
Yeah.
But they stood out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, every single one of them, I mean, if you go to YouTube, there's actually a mega clip where someone put them all together. And they're all good. I mean, every single one of them's got a decent hook in it of, hey, that's so-and-so. And it became a thing. You know, you could tell, you know, somebody was, you know, every single person that makes an appearance was someone who was pretty popular at the time. I mean, the Addams Family pops up. Dick Clark pops up.
Sammy Davis Jr.
Yeah, it was like who's who?
Oh, yeah, no, absolutely. I mean,
that's for me. It became something that the show was known for, even though it didn't happen that much. So that every time they climb a building and it doesn't happen, you still kind of go, wait a minute, where's?
Well, because those people who all appeared knew that being on Batman got them attention. And if they couldn't commit themselves possibly to an entire episode, you know, as a villain, well, right. I'll get my 2 minutes, 3 minutes of fame talking to Batman out the window.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I mean, you're right. It worked. It was iconic. It was memorable. And in each case, it usually, you know, broadened the guest appearances appeal, with the exception of, I think one was probably the Green Hornet one. Nothing with the Green Hornet seemed to work.
Which is a shame.
Get past its first season. No, you're right, because it was a great show. Mm-hmm. But I think the mistake was trying to intersect those two universes when, you know, Green Hornet was done so differently.
Yeah, that's a whole other podcast.
Yeah, exactly. So Batman and Robin make it up to the apartment. They try to switch out the jewel in Ms. Starr's safe. And, you know, I like it because, you know, he's got the squelcher to silence the alarm if it should go off. He's listening with the tumblers. Everything's going well, but...
Gotcha, you thieves! One move and you're gonna get to him!
Holy bat trap!
Let's fight our way out of this.
So instead of switching it around, like you're thinking Batman will catch him in the act of stealing, we got him catching Batman. And, you know, we get a quick fight breaking out, and they get away.
Well, I love the fact that, wow, we got you. Batman's reaction is, we'll fight our way out of this.
Yes.
The actual line is, we'll fight our way out of
this. He says, we'll fight our way out of it while the guns are pointed at them. Like, start the fight. Don't say we'll fight. Like, because by the time any other sensible person is like, well, we'll fight our way back.
Yeah.
You know? Bang.
You see, they have initiative on the guns.
It's D&D.
That's right.
You just stand there now. I have initiative. I get to whack you first.
They won't get far.
And then we find, you know, the Penguin's got his benefit carnival coming up to raise money and such. And Batman knows about it. Well, he finds out about it from, of all people, Commissioner Gordon. And it's like, he even says to him, you know, if you come in, I have to arrest you. Then if you do that, why did you tell him? You know why? Because he knows he's Batman, and he knows he's going to come in. And he knows he's got to try and do something. And yeah.
Yeah, which leads to my favorite trick umbrella, the whole two-parter, the cement-filled umbrella.
Yeah, that drops on the two of them.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's like, really, a cement-filled umbrella? That's just bizarre. Okay, I'll buy it. Bonk. Okay, yeah, they're out.
They're out. It works.
Batman and Robin, a swinging pair of dead ducks. What on earth can save them? Don't shoot, Commissioner! Don't shoot!
All set, my hotties?
We're set.
Now, on my instructions.
Ready? Aim.
Good grief! Good night! Double funeral tomorrow. Same bat time, same bat channel. Can you see any way out?
And that's the other thing I like about this one is it's a nice ironic death trap because they're going to have the commissioner and Chief O'Hara do the deed.
They're going to do the deed, but they have got to be the most incompetent police officers. Yeah. I mean, like, I know we joked about this, but here is one that really takes the cake because for whatever else, yeah, they're umbrella guns. They still have recoil when real bullets are in them in order to propel them out.
Well, actually, they do say, wow, that had a bit of kick for a pellet gun, didn't it?
Oh, they did say that. No, you're right. Okay, I take that back. They did say that. Although
the fact that they didn't think further beyond that is kind of the, so, wait a minute, why would it have such a kick? I don't know, but we got $1,000 for the PBA, so.
Yeah, exactly. They're just more concerned about the money. Here's the other thing, too. This death trap only works as long as Batman and Robin are still knocked out. And, of course, at the last moment, they start to come around and can lift themselves up from bullets.
Yeah, and at first you think it's like, oh, they just got out of the way of bullets. But then the whole, you know, well, of course we have bulletproof soles on our feet. You know, which, I'm sorry, but still, even with, you know, a bulletproof sole, you got to give Batman credit for having stones not to scream when a bullet slams into his foot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, that's
and of course the shock of getting shot, knocking his bat knife free in his glove so he could cut his way out.
Right. What I liked though was that for a while there, they make it look like, you know, Batman is well, not dead necessarily, but like he's out of it. Like they have to keep him, but Penguin forces the issue. Like I want him brought in. He's a threat to the city. And you know, we're
and
still
enough high influence friends now to actually put the commissioner on the spot.
Exactly. Exactly. Including Miss Starr, who sits there in the office and says, you better do something or else, you know, there's going to be trouble for you. And so the commissioner has no choice.
What's the matter, commissioner? Your famous hotline out of order?
Penguin, don't touch that fool.
Yes, commissioner.
Quack, quack. I'm on the track.
Penguin.
No answer, eh?
The heat is on, Batman. You'd better come in and give yourself up on that burglary charge.
Instantly, do you understand?
I'll see you, Penguin. I'll be at your protective agency office in 25 minutes.
Did you hear that? He's on his way to attack me. I demand protection.
Just pushes Batman, you know, so that he's like, I'm coming to your office. Not to the commissioner's office. I'm coming to your office, Penguin, in 25 minutes. So Penguin's like, you hear that? It's a threat. It's a threat. I mean, it's just nicely done. This, I wasn't a big fan of the first Penguin episode. I didn't think it was as well put together. This one, again, it's silly. There's some circumstantial type stuff, but it flows a lot better. And again, we still don't know what Penguin's ultimate goal is. Because even up to this point, even though he's been shifty and yeah, he tried to kill Batman, there might be something legit. Maybe he's just killing Batman because he doesn't want competition in crime fighting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's possible.
Yeah, it's possible he may have gone straight, but he's just still, you know, got it in for Batman because, you know, it's Batman.
Right.
But I like that. You're right. This one, he's a man with a plan. He sticks to it the entire time.
Yes.
You know, the whole killing Batman at the carnival was just a, hey, I've got the opportunity. I'm going to seize it.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
But then back to the plan.
Yeah. Exactly. And I like it's ironic. You know, you talk about the irony before. It's also ironic that the Penguin who runs a protection agency wants protection from Batman, from the police.
Mm-hmm.
He turns to the police. Meanwhile, the police turn to Batman whenever they need help. There's that weird line when Batman and Robin finally make it to the Penguin's office and they burst in and they're twitching and they're just like,
your super brain power has driven us mad, Penguin. Something snapped. We don't care if we go up the river for 100 years. We're getting you first.
Quick, my things. Self-defense. The dynamic duo has flipped their wits.
They've snapped. You've defeated us with your super brain power. Oh, my God. But he delivers it so well, Adam West. He says it that you're willing to accept it.
And just, it's a
very funny question. Obviously, all these heads stuck sideways in his arm. Like, oh, it took me a second, like, what the hell? It's gone crazy. Okay.
He's got the threats going there or something.
Batman, listen! It's the police! Let's get out of here!
I don't know, but he was really that was his time to be the ham, where normally, you know, he wasn't the ham. He was just always sincere and a little bit too eager, but he's hamming it up there with it for him. You know, I think good for him. I think Burt Ward has always been underrated, you know, mm-hmm. as far as his portrayal of Robin. I still say best Robin ever.
Yeah. Of the classic Robin, classic style Robin in the elfin boots. Yeah. He did a great job.
Yeah,
I mean, there's a reason the holy whatever became a catchphrase.
It was because of him.
Yeah, that's the thing. He, as campy as the show got and as silly as the show got, you could still see the earnestness, which is what made Batman and Robin work as characters and in the show, is there was that earnestness at the core.
Yes, definitely.
An earnestness and a decency.
We get another bat fight. And again, it's another one where they're able to dodge bullets. They're able to, you know, the bullets go off and they are able to disarm them. I'm like thinking, damn, you are this close to Batman and Robin and you can't seem with machine guns even. Those were machine guns, right? And you couldn't shoot them.
Mm-hmm. I tell you, Batman's got initiative.
Hey, he does.
Sunk all of his points in initiative and gadgets. My Champions players know what I'm talking about.
Or if this were
he's got a high dex.
If this was Marvel, you'd be using karma. But you know, they fight. And the cops are coming, so they make a run for it. And again, more exterior, more awesome. You know, even though it's the backlots of 20th Century Fox, who cares? It's great. They're using the streets there, and the Batmobile's trying to get away from the cops. You get a bat turn and everything. I mean, that was the really cool stuff. And I have to wonder, there's a scene when part of the chase scene, the Batmobile makes a bank turn around the corner. And there's, what would you say, a pole, a pedestal, a stone pole, like a stone column at the corner. And as I'm looking at the scene to a certain extent, it's not as wide, but damn it, if it doesn't remind me, and if I wonder if he was inspired by Tim Burton in, I think it was Batman Returns, when Batman shoots the line to the stone column and makes the turn the way he did. Because it
That's
looks like it's
possible.
Set. It looks like it's set up detailed specific, but just, you know, the street looked like it could have been shot from, you know, Michael Keaton's Batman movie.
That's entirely plausible.
I liked it. And although I will say this much, after all this trouble, you know, because Batman and Robin, they're cornered, they get out of the car, they run down an alley, they're shot down. Oh my God, they're dead. What does Penguin do? He steals the Batmobile.
That is just brilliant of the one cop, the one thug leaning in going, "Hey, Penguin, let's take the Batmobile."
Capital idea.
It's like, the police aren't going to mind that at all.
Yeah. you know, it's like they turn around and where'd the Batmobile go? Mm-hmm. You know, but you see right there is when if you had any doubt that maybe this was just something more, like maybe it was just between he took the Batmobile, you know, he can't help himself.
Which is like a recurring thing for the Penguin. He's always trying to get his hands on the Batmobile.
Well, yes, he is. He is. He's fascinated with the Batmobile. And, of course, he tricks it out so that it's, you know, his Birdmobile now.
Mm-hmm. Which I love the fact that offends Batman more than anything else.
Oh, yeah. I mean, at the very end when he says, "We got to fumigate the car," you know? But
it's like, yeah, he shot at me. He's framed me for a criminal and this, but he took my car.
Yep. And the thing is, like, he turns around and... You know, not only does he detail the car, you know, with you know, Penguin gadgets, and it's got the Penguin symbol on it instead of the bat symbol there.
And the pink umbrella.
And the pink umbrella. But he refers to it, you know, a number of times as a black raven or a black crow, you know, because when he starts getting frustrated with the car later on, we'll get into that in a moment. There, you know, you talk about, like, certain scenes where things happen and you wonder, like, how the script may have changed it. The next scene that comes up, because now Batman and Robin are declared dead and, you know, they're going to let them think that they are dead. The first scene we cut to is Alfred and Aunt Harriet watching TV.
In view of their past services, I've given orders that they be buried with full police honors. Despite the fact they died as fugitive felons?
Yes, George, despite that fact. Nothing can erase the memory of the deeds they performed before they became unhinged.
Tell me, Commissioner, what do you think brought about this?
Batman and Robin dead? What in the world is going to become of us?
Perhaps that's a better question than you realize, madam.
Oh, I wish Bruce and Dick were here. Maybe they could console me.
I doubt that very much, Mrs. Cooper. I doubt it very much.
And Alfred is clearly, you know, troubled because he's like, oh, crap, I gotta tell her that Dick and Bruce aren't coming back because he's not in on this scam. And I'm like, you're sitting there and you're waiting and you're like, is he going to do it now? All right. No, he cuts away. We never get another scene with the two of them.
We never get the payoff for that because, you know, she makes the whatever will we do? And he says, you have no idea how relevant that question is.
Yes.
The exact line. But yeah.
Yeah. Because then we cut to they're down in the Batcave. It's like, hello, quick phone call upstairs and just let Alfred know we're okay.
Yeah.
You know, let Alfred know we're okay. And for that matter, why didn't Sophia Starr notice that Penguin's driving around in a car that looks strangely familiar?
Yeah. Yeah, everybody buys it. Oh, it's just a Birdmobile. Okay.
Yeah. Wow. even a quick line. I bought it at an auction. You know, police auction did away. I mean, she'd have bought that because she was gullible enough.
Yeah, she was quite gullible.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Right up to the very end.
Mm-hmm.
But now we also see, because like I said, they're presumed dead. They want to make sure the Penguin thinks they're dead until it's time to spring on him. Some time must have passed because we got the scene of them watching, Penguin in the car and they're watching him. And then we get to the paper announcement of him stopping another criminal crime, which wasn't the crime he stopped while he was out on the street in the Birdmobile. And then we get to his proposal, and then we get to the wedding day. So I even at most, I'd say a week or two has passed.
Yeah, at least.
At least, right?
Yeah.
So now
we're still at this point don't know what the scam is.
We still don't know what the scam is because he's capturing criminals. Mind you, it's set up ones from the looks of it because, well, we saw on the street that was one of his guys. But you're also wondering, what about other criminals? Is he bothering to round those up too, or is he letting them? Because I would assume he'd have to keep the charade up all the way. So, you know, because that's 2 weeks without, let's say 2 weeks. Let's just say it could probably be even more. But let's say 2 weeks. 2 weeks without Batman patrolling the streets and even stopping the common criminal in a town that has heard that Batman is dead.
Yeah, why isn't crime running rampant? Right. Unless they're all like, oh no, the Penguin is doing it now.
Yeah, because I can't imagine him turning around and going, boys, it's okay. You know, I mean, there have been other stories where it's like, you know, I'll look the other way, you know, even though I'm pretending to be the good guy. They'll do that in future episodes. Not this one, though. There isn't anything like that. And again, it plays into nicely because, like you said, we don't know, still don't know up to this point what the real scam is. And that's what makes this episode work for me. You know, now I have one question. Have you ever been to a wedding where they serve the buffet before the wedding ceremony?
No.
Yeah, because from the looks of it, I thought they were already married. When she goes, oh, we have a buffet over here, you know, and the gifts are over there if you want to look, you know, and take a look at what gifts we got and all this stuff that which they have on display.
Yeah. I love the fact that there was an actual mini oil derrick to represent the oil derrick in Texas. And they had to say, well, no, the deed's in the envelope at the bottom. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Oh man,
I thought that was cute.
Yeah, no, it was cute. And the what was it, the rhinestone encrusted can opener, electric
diamond
can opener?
Encrusted can opener. Yeah,
that was it, diamond. Yeah. that was pretty good. You know, they sure got their money's worth though out of that Batmobile. I mentioned it earlier, they got their money's worth out of the Batmobile green screen shot, because you got the initial one, then there's another one later on, then there's the Penguin and his guys.
Yeah.
In the Batmobile. And then even later, we get for the first time the introduction of the Bat Cycle.
Yes.
This is the first episode. And they're all green screen in that whole thing, which is pretty funny. Because what the Penguin does is he sets up basically a distraction of, you know, sprinklers and noise and what everything's going off. And as it is, he's got the table holding the gifts rigged to dump it all into a chute, which sends it down to the parking lot area where it's all piling up nicely inside the Batmobile trunk.
Yes.
And then he's like, oh my God, the stuff is stolen. So he's still keeping up the act. It's looking all good. And he's like, we're going to go after them. And off they go, he and his two stooges, to drive off with all this loot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, leaving behind his jilted bride.
Yep. And that's the thing. It's I was watching this, and I'm like, you know, Penguin, if you married her, all this stuff would be yours legally. But that is just his reaction of, God, me, marry God, for heaven forbid, no.
Well, see, that's the thing, because like I said, up until he makes the point of, I've got all this stuff and I'm a bachelor too.
Yes.
You know, I realized, I'm like, oh, he didn't marry. Because I thought at first maybe he did go through with the wedding. Because again, the buffet. And it's like, okay, because that's called a reception. Yes. You know, and I'm like, you missed that. You know,
yeah,
and it's
that would have been, that's an interesting conversation that we did not get to see. No, no, honey, we'll have the reception first. And first, then we'll get married.
Then we'll get married. You know, and it's funny because little things like that should annoy me. As someone who appreciates a good story, as someone who writes himself, and mm-hmm. but you know, when it comes to this and everything else is working, you're okay with it. Especially considering they cover themselves later on with lines to the effect of, you know, and I'm still a bachelor. So okay, all right. It's weird, but at least you didn't walk away with the impression that not only are you a jerk for, you know, setting this whole thing up and everything, but then you married the poor girl and left her, you know,
left her at the altar. And
right.
Which also plays to the child audience, who at this, you know, a lot of the, you know, the young boys watching it, this, like, eek, girls.
Yeah, exactly. So he gets away, Batmobile, and driving down this road. I guess he's trying to head out of Gotham City. And Batman
and I love
Robin
the fact that his thugs have to ride double up.
Well, you know, there's not
only
a lot
two
of room.
Seats.
That's it.
Yeah, it just amuses me that the one guy has to sit in the other one's lap. Like, oh man.
and they're kind of looking annoyed at each other as they're trying to get comfortable, you know, which I like. But they're driving down the road. Batman's following quite a distance from the looks of it too, because mm-hmm. and we'll get into that in a moment. But
time to jolt him with our gimmicks, huh?
Roger. We'll start by giving his two stooges a short, sweet voyage into space. Here goes the remote control ejector button.
I must have accidentally hit some granite button.
Now, for some amusing fun with the doors.
Sold up secondhand cars. Amazing nice price. This bird is beginning to fly here. Come here. A raven gets a tail flip.
Look at him, Robin. That crooked bird's going crazy.
Be careful, Batman. We don't want him to smash up the Batmobile.
Good point, Robin. I'll take over the steering now by remote control.
Again, another little point they've mentioned at the beginning. Now it's finally going into play here. Maybe not the windshield, but at least some of the other gimmick. I didn't even mind. I kind of laughed at the little toy steering wheel.
Yeah.
In the bat cycle. It was funny.
It's very
funny. It was funny.
Yeah. Batman messing with, you know, just screwing with the Penguin at this point.
No, absolutely. Although Adam West was a little overeager. Oh, yeah. It's definitely paid. Well, he gets a little too overeager, though, when he's like, ha, ha, ha. See that, Robin? He's going crazy. I'm like, all right. That one you need to tone down just a little bit there, Adam. That one particular line. But I'm also curious, when the bat cycle finally catches up with the two crooks and they're getting up off the ground, dusting themselves off, they're talking, the bat cycle is still well off in the distance. I mean, they can hear it, they can see it coming towards them, and they go, oh my God, it's a pair of ghosts.
Ghosts, huh? I don't think you crooks have the right spirit.
And the bike stops and Robin goes, ghosts, huh? I'll show you ghosts. And it's like, how did you hear that?
It's that clean living.
Yeah.
The Batmobile! Let's get the controls!
Oh, man. And of course, you know, we get another quick bat fight out there with the two of them as the Penguin shows up. And, you know, again, another gunshot and totally misses. Mm-hmm. totally misses. In which, you know, I did like the fact, though, that the three of them were all trussed up on the trunk of the car as they drive away. That was a nice touch.
Yeah.
You know, and yet despite everything, we come to the end and there's Miss Star again, and she's willing to try and rehabilitate the Penguin. You know, if I just give him love and all this, and of course, what's he do? He sees all the gifts still laid out in the commissioner's office, and he's like running towards, totally ignoring her now at this point.
This was mine, and this was mine.
Because in the end, it still plays to his base nature, which I did like. It's like, yeah, there is that part of him that wants to be accepted, but there is that part of him that's just greedy.
Mm-hmm.
And that's always going to overwhelm his other desires, is his greed.
Yep.
You know, which is just a nice touch.
Yeah. The Penguin, Mary, take me to prison.
Yes.
Burgess Meredith is just a joy to watch. And that's why I always like the Penguin episodes, because he really does. I mean, some of the special guest villains, you can tell, well, I'm here because this is popular, or I'm here because it's a paycheck. But Burgess is just gets into it.
Mm-hmm.
And just chews the scenery as hard as he can. And I like the fact he's always clever. And he just falls into character. And I think that's one of the reasons, you know, I mean, his portrayal of Penguin is iconic.
Right.
I mean, even to the point, you know, where future Penguins, you know, will do some sort of variation on the ah, wah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's one thing that got taken right from the show was that.
Yeah.
You know, the official Batman Bat Book by Joel Eisner. The second edition is out, and I'll have links for it up on Amazon. But this is like, it's an episode guide. It's got interviews with the various, you know, stars and such. And you mentioned that. Burgess Meredith said, I did Batman for two reasons. One of which was salary. The other was that after its first few episodes, Batman became the in thing to do. Everybody, including Frank Sinatra, although I don't remember Frank Sinatra being on, would either play a villain or appear as himself in that cameo showcase where a celebrity would poke his head through the window of a building that Batman and Robin were climbing. I even remember Otto Preminger saying to me, my God, my son won't speak to me unless I get a job on Batman. Eventually, he got in. Actually, we didn't get as much money from the show as you might think, although we were paid decent money for the feature film version. The main impetus to continue appearing on Batman beyond the dramatic was fashionable. You know, and that's the thing. And that it was fashionable. I mean, everybody, and that's why the window gags were created, was so that you could have more celebs who may not have had the time. But unfortunately, that fashionability, and this is something I'm going to keep referring to, is why in the later seasons, you were tailoring villains to people who wanted to appear on the show instead of tailoring people on the to come on the show based on villains you wanted to do. So you get these weird villains who really didn't have much substance to them. And they were high, you know, over the top acting it out. Yeah, it was kind of funny, but it took away from the real charm of these early first season episodes in that regard, because it never matches it.
Yeah, well, it became gimmick. And once it becomes a gimmick, it's never quite as good.
Right. So the writer on this episode was Lorenzo Semple. And we've talked about him here on the podcast. He's going to go on to write the Batman movie. He writes many of the more popular episodes of the first season. He's the one who really sets the pace in the initial run of the show. It's not going to always follow that, obviously, and that's why eventually you don't see his name on the show anymore. I think he probably got tired of, you know, it not being taken as seriously. I mean, this is a guy who would go on to write scripts for, you know, he did the Flash Gordon movie.
Yeah.
He was the writer of the Flash Gordon movie. I mean, this guy is creative.
Mm-hmm.
You know? He wrote this episode with a guy named John Cardwell, and Cardwell's only credit was Batman, this one episode. He never wrote anything else, so.
Yeah. And it was directed by Leslie Martinson, who went to do the movie.
Right. Yep. And you can definitely see again, you know, Martinson, even like the scenes outside with the Batcycle and the Batmobile, there's almost a cinematic quality to it, the way he shoots from certain angles and such. I mean, not only just the simple tilting of the camera, the way Batman was famous for. It works. And you can see why he was chosen then to do the movie version.
Yeah. But that's something is the Dutch angles in this episode aren't nearly as extreme as they get later. I mean, it's some, you know, in the later episodes, they're almost like at 90 degrees at some point.
Oh, yeah.
I think they overplayed it.
oh yeah, well, you know, just like everything else, it's like, oh, the kid's like that, we'll do more. So, you know, to the point where you don't appreciate it anymore. What is your favorite bat gadget out of all the ones in this episode?
Well, that's the thing. He really doesn't gadget that much. I mean, we get the batarangs, and he even uses them. He just kind of holds them threateningly. You know, you're going to get a batarang.
You're right.
And then the the transmitter and the cigarette holder.
Yeah. Which fails anyway.
Yeah. So, yeah, I'll go with the batarang.
All right. Okay. I'm going to go with the bulletproof windshield that never gets used.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, from the official Batman Bat Book, he also, Joel Eisner, for each episode includes a trivia question. So let me ask you this. What was the name of the insurance company that Alfred tells the Penguin he represents when he goes to take the pictures of Miss Starr's jewelry?
It was Lloyd's of Dublin. I know it was a play on Lloyd's of London.
Mm-hmm. Close.
Yeah, which was what tickled me. It's like, oh, okay. But yeah, it was something of Dublin, wasn't it?
Yeah, Floyd's.
Floyd's
of Dublin. Okay. Very good, though. Very good. You're the first one in a while who's gotten close to it, though. All right. So now, you finish watching the episode. You are Robin the Boy Wonder. And you turn to Batman, because we don't rate things here on scales of 1 to 5 or 1 to 10. There's no batarangs or anything. We rate it according to holy blank. How would you rate this episode of Batman if you were Robin the Boy Wonder? Holy
Holy nefarious. I think it was very well done. I thought that Penguin's plot was a good idea, and he stuck to it, and he almost got away with it.
He did almost get away with it, except his greed got the better of him. And frankly, if he just left the Batmobile alone, I think that's what really was his ultimate undoing.
Because Batman was able to put the cameras in there to catch him on tape confessing to it, and then catch him with the goods red-handed.
Right. Yeah.
You know, if he just got a Studebaker.
Get your own Birdmobile. You're going to be rich enough soon enough. You know? Mm-hmm. I would say Holy High Society.
Yeah.
You know, because this is going to be the first of several episodes where Penguin's going to try and worm his way into, you know, upper echelons of people and earn their trust in order to dupe them into doing something or getting something from them. I still say also this is a much better episode than Penguin's first one, his debut one, which I found very flawed. Yeah, there's some minor flaws here, but it doesn't overwhelm what is actually a much superior episode for him in many respects. Well, that's going to do it. I mean, unless there's anything else you wanted to bring up as far, but I think we cut it all, right?
I did want to mention, it seems like a complete throwaway, and it was just out of nowhere but funny, of Penguin when he calls the commissioner to tell him about the wedding or about the party, and he's just eating the raw sardines out of the jar.
Yes.
It's like, he's really into his penguinness.
He's into his penguinness. It's funny. If I seem to remember correctly, again, maybe that's where I'm getting all this from with the Batman Returns. This may have been in some ways an inspiration for Tim Burton, this episode, because I seem to remember Danny DeVito devouring something kind of nastily the way Burgess Meredith was eating in that episode. Because I was like looking at him going, you could see the sauce and stuff in his teeth. And I'm just like, ew.
Yeah.
You know? It was a little bit gross. Batman Returns. So yeah, I think we might be touching on one of his inspirations to do that movie. You know, and again, the whole, you know, Penguin wanting to be in high society there as well.
As a ruse.
As a ruse, exactly. You know, as we come to the end of this episode, Gary, let me ask you, how can people find out more about what's going on with you, what you're doing? How do they get a hold of, you know, the RevCast podcast? And, you know, and information about DragonCon.
Well, information on DragonCon, you can go to DragonCon.org. That is the main DragonCon webpage. If you want to find out about the American Sci-Fi Classics track, we have a Facebook group. Oddly enough, it is the Facebook/American Sci-Fi Classics. Mm-hmm. And we also have our own webpage, which we can link to from the Facebook group. Let's see here. Yeah, American Sci-Fi Classics track. You can get hold of me by Twitter as Gary_Mitchell, and that's Mitchell with one L. And yeah, it's my real name for Star Trek fans. And you can reach myself and Deanna, host of the RevCast, at revolutionsf.com. We are on the Facebook as well. And revolutionsf.com is our web.
Keep an ear out for that, folks. We'll also have links for all this on our show notes for this episode, so it'll be easy for you to access. So that's going to do it then for this episode of the Batcave Podcast. Tune in 2 weeks' time.
Next week, return match with the Riddler.
And joining me for that episode is also the return of Andy Leyland of the Hey Kids Comics Podcast. We had such a great time last time talking about Mr. Freeze. He wanted to crack at Frank Gorshin and the Riddler. So until next time, Gary, thanks so much for being here. Everyone,
goodbye, everybody.
Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave Podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com, or by phone at 888-866-9010. Subscribe to the podcast via libsyn.com. That's libsyn.com. Or through iTunes. The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at chronicrift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.
Star, all the stolen gifts recovered.
I wonder.
What, Miss Star?
The love and affection I'd provide. It might be just the thing that would turn him into an honest, law-abiding citizen.
Great Scott, Miss Star, you mean you'd still consider becoming that crooked bird's wife?
Why not? I'd make him a nest where he'd feel warm and protected and loved. It's a challenge to quicken any woman's heart.
Officer, bring in Penguin.
Oh, my dear Pengy. My poor little sick bird.
It was mine, I tell you, it was all in my grip. This was my oil well. And this was my solid gold dinner service. And this was my diamond-studded can opener.
Greedy bird, have you no conscience?
This woman loves you, Penguin. She's still willing to marry you.
Who, me? The Penguin? Married and kept in a bathtub?
I love you, Pengy. I try very hard to reform you.
Great heavenly ice rolls! Take me to prison!
Hi, I'm Keith Ari DeCandido, international best-selling and award-winning author of over 40 novels, as well as comic books, short stories, novellas, and more. I'm also an editor, currently hiring out through Creditorial, a musician, currently percussionist for the Boogie Nights, and a whole lot more. Hear me talk about my writing and my life, and also do readings for my work on my twice-monthly podcast, Dead Kitchen Radio, part of the Chronic Rift Network. For more information, go to chronicrift.com or to deadkitchenradio.mevio.com.
What a vain bird am I, a fortune in wedding gifts, and still a bachelor.
What a dastardly, twisted plot.
That Penguin's some foul bird.
Not only robbing his own wedding, but leaving that trusting girl at the altar.
Let's go get him, huh?
Right you are, Robin.
Cyborg.
Two longtime fans of two Bionic shows discuss an episode in detail every 2 weeks with one guest host. The $6 million man, the Bionic woman, the mythology, a look behind the scenes, those sound effects, and the fashions. Oh my God, the fashions. Cyborgs, a Bionic podcast. Hosted by John S. Drew and Paul K. Bisson. Find us at chronicrift.com/cyborgs or subscribe on iTunes.
sci-fi, 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 sci-fi.